1964, at the bidding of the United States, the New Zealand government sent soldiers to the front line of the Cold War in Southeast Asia. For 8 years, our men did tours of duty in the maelstrom called the Vietnam War. It killed 37 of them and wounded 187, officially. But when our soldiers returned home, they were outcasts, strangers in a strange new world. And something in their service continued to haunt them and kill them. They and their families have lived with a legacy that is silent, patient, and deadly.
When I was a child, I never thought I'd have to be looked after as an adult. I didn't know there was anything wrong with me. I never saw that for myself. I thought I'd be a normal functioning citizen, but I'm not. I just feel like I'm in a constant black hole. I can't get out. Nothing ever seems to get better. My father says be positive, things might get better, but I know from experience that they don't.
The legacy of Vietnam has lasted for over 30 years. But veterans fear the fallout will continue unchecked for 30 more. Vietnam has always known war. It has been a battlefield for over 1,000 years, a glittering prize known as the Food Bowl of Asia. From 1947 on, US foreign policy was on a course of containment of communism. The New Zealand government, whilst agreeing with US Cold War concerns, had qualms about becoming directly involved. Vietnam was a political war, one that New Zealand was directed to participate in for political ends. We effectively joined the Vietnam conflict in 1964, but only after serious urging and pushing from the United States. In May of 1965, New Zealand Prime Minister Keith Holyoake made the decision to deploy 161 Battery Royal New Zealand Artillery. Infantry companies Victor and Whiskey arrived later for year-long tours of duty. In total, nearly 3,500 men served in Vietnam. Many Kiwis mistakenly believed that the New Zealand soldiers who served were volunteers, men who asked to be sent to Vietnam. It's a misconception. They were regular forces, professionals sent wherever the government decreed. The Vietnam War as we know it was known as the American War by the Vietnamese, and it was conducted throughout South Vietnam in many different places simultaneously. South Vietnam was divided into four military regions, numbering from the North-South Division of the 17th parallel southward. The New Zealand Armed Forces served in Zone 3, which incorporated Binh Hoa in Saigon and Nui Dat and Vung Tau in the province of Phuc Toi. From June of 1966, 161 Battery was assigned to the 1st Australian Task Force at Nui Dat, operating from there in support of the Australian and New Zealand infantry units, although they could be called on to support anywhere within Phuc Toi province. And our New Zealand soldiers were highly respected as a fighting force by everybody in the field. They operated in silence, used sign language, and shunned the tracks. They were sometimes called grey ghosts by the Vietnamese, and they were known as Tan Thai Lan, the undetected.
Their job was to kill the enemy. Their job was to combat the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese communist forces. And they didn't do that by talking to them or arguing with them or anything like that. They did it with weapons in their hands.
Every time we're in action against the enemy, we were the victors. We never lost a battle.
I beg your pardon. I never promised you a rose garden along with the sunshine. There's gotta be a little rain sometime.
The Vietnam conflict was the first war in which public perception proved to be the biggest weapon of all. It was the world's first television war, the world's first rock and roll war. Networks nightly screened the pictures coming from in country. It was frightening, it was fascinating, and it was escalating. And it was the first time we saw what a truly disgusting business war is, the grisly reality of men killing other men.
policeman ordered him back into the car and the driver ran. At that moment, the bomb exploded, killing both the terrorist and the policeman.
Trun T. Mai, 7 years old, was found by the first paratroopers to enter this neighborhood just a few hours earlier. Her parents, she said, ran away when the fighting started. That was 2 months ago. They left her behind, Mai told the paratroopers, because she could not walk.
It was a small action, a small battle, but this is how the war must be fought in Vietnam.
This is Tony Smith, Television One News in Saigon.
The Vietnam conflict was a war that had no front line. It kept moving. And most actions were cordon and search operations. They went out into the villages and the paddies and the rice fields, the valleys and the mountains, hunting for an enemy who was trained in the ways of guerrilla warfare from childhood.
The jungle is a terrible place to fight anyone. The jungle on its own is a real problem. Without having someone walking along and behind any tree, there could be a guy coming out and wants to shoot you.
The VC were a highly skilled enemy, highly trained, highly motivated, and similarly equipped, but on home soil.
The situation was where the Americans used to provide to these villages bags of rice and support, and saying, if you're on our side, we'll give you bags of rice and we'll support you. The Viet Cong used to say, you be an outsider, we'll shoot you, take your pick.
It was a war in which children were heavily involved by the Viet Cong, and so there was the desperate psychological damage done to some of the soldiers that I know, who, having found themselves in combat and having conducted themselves very well, having killed the enemy, having gone to the proper process of clearing an area and then gone and had a look at the bodies and found they were children. Some of them were young girls or something like that.
To find the enemy in the lush countryside, the Allied troops first needed to be able to see them, and chemicals were deployed by the US Air Force in pursuit of that tactical objective. Spraying originally began as a food denial program called Operation Hades, although it was later reclassified as depriving cover for enemy troops. However, seeing the cataclysmic effects of the spraying, US PR gurus decided that Hades was too accurate a term and renamed it, more innocuously, Operation Ranch Hand. Between 1961 and 1971, US Air Force Operation Ranch Hand sprayed agents pink, purple, green and orange, along with agents white and blue. They were named for the identification color bands on the 208-liter drums. The agents were sprayed from the air by C-123 Hercules aircraft fitted with 1,000-gallon tanks. But there were also localized spraying operations, by hand, around camps, perimeters, waterways and roads. US Air Force records show that Zone 3, where the New Zealanders served, received a greater volume of spraying than the other three zones combined. Over 20 million litres of Agent Orange. Phuc Toi Province alone received over 750,000 litres.
We were in fact doused with millions and millions of litres of it. Working in the jungle with it, we were drinking in our water, we were showering in it, our food was prepared in it.
We were actually sprayed with Agent Orange once in the morning, once at night. The guys used to stand in it because it was nice and cool.
And I had two mess tins, which I was holding in my hand, walking away from the cookhouse. I had a rifle over my shoulder, and the spray came down upon me. And I recall saying to a group of soldiers I walked past, wouldn't you bloody know it, lunchtime.
The soldiers had no way of knowing what was being sprayed or what the effects might be. They assumed that the government knew what they were doing and that it was safe for human contact.
The effects of it, other than taking a very vibrant, lush, green jungle into absolutely grey, lifeless sticks where grass and leaves turned to grey powder and no animals were existent and no birds flew. I came home in 1971, and it was probably 8 to 10 years later that we first heard the word Agent Orange.
Throughout the Kiwi soldiers' time in Vietnam, through the 60s and into the 70s, the entire Western world was undergoing enormous social reform and upheaval. From a straight-laced society, barriers were being broken down as student and youth cultures flourished and flower power blossomed into being. Protest groups appeared. Groups like Tim Shadbolt and the PYM, the Progressive Youth Movement. Demonstrations were staged in Auckland, Wellington and Christchurch. Increasingly, the government was fielding calls to get our troops out now. But the New Zealand forces in Vietnam were largely unaware of the situation at home. It was to be a major shock when they returned to hostility from almost every sector of society.
Peasants of Vietnam, how can your gardens grow with plant disease and withered trees and graves all in a row?
In December of 1972, the New Zealand government withdrew our remaining forces from Vietnam. Ceasefire occurred in January of 73, and Saigon fell to the communist regime in April of 1975. As far as the North was concerned, their reunification war was over and won. But on their return to New Zealand, our boys were hidden away, told to deny their service for the country. There was no counselling or support to help them adjust to civilian life. New Zealand had become strongly anti-war, and many wrongly perceived our returning soldiers as the perpetrators of it.
Once they put me off the aeroplane, they said goodbye, David. They gave me $10 or 20 bucks, whatever it was, enough to pay for a bed somewhere for the night, and wishing me good luck. And no one ever came and spoke to me again.
You would get beaten up. You actually used to explain your short haircut by saying you just got out of prison. The rest of your mates were, well, certainly from down in Southland, they had their quarter acre section, their pavlova and their half gallon jar, and Vietnam was a different world. It didn't mean a lot.
That was the climate under which these men returned, and it produced a very, very disorientated and cynical and untrusting group of men who went about just as their predecessors did, trying to find a job and getting married and that sort of thing.
For almost every combatant, the Vietnam War was the most intense experience of their lives. The endless fear and tension and adrenaline in effect stretched the men almost like an overinflated balloon, and they were unable to return to everyday life. They were haunted by alcoholism, depression, illness, rejection, and suicide. There's a catch-all term for these conditions brought on by such extreme situations. PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder.
Military training trains you, when you have a contact, to turn towards the contact, to turn towards it, take up a position, and be prepared to move towards where the contact is coming from. So that is counterintuitive to normal human behavior. And when you're thoroughly trained in that way, and you start to associate in your mind that with survival, it becomes very difficult to turn that off later in life.
I can't allow balloons. My counselor tried to tell me that balloons don't hurt you, and he's absolutely right. But balloons tend to go bang when you least expect it. And so I don't like balloons, and if I see a place that's got balloons in it, I avoid it. My children, when they were young children, wondered why they weren't allowed to have balloons at Christmas time. Well, they now know, because balloons go bang.
PTSD and its social repercussions were not the only setbacks that veterans faced. Serious health ramifications of service in Vietnam began appearing in the veterans and their children.
The effects of Agent Orange really had a latency period, except for children and except for wives and families, because these young men who went away 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 came back, and clearly they were the sort of blokes who would get married very quickly, start families, and they were getting married and they were having enormous issues with stillbirth, with premature birth.
On the loss of my own child, the pressures were immense because it was our first child, and for her to become pregnant again, she was very how can we put it? She didn't want to go through the experience of bearing a child and then losing it again.
Living with a time bomb. My wife and I, 7 miscarriages. No one could say why.
I personally suffer from bad skin burning, itching, especially if I get wet. If I get out in the rain and my clothes get wet, my skin burns. I'm always saying to my wife, please scratch this, I've got an itchy, something's bitten me, and there's nothing there, there's nothing to see.
But I can think offhand of 3 or 4 people I know who have children who are deformed one way or another, subsequently, were born subsequent to service in South Vietnam. And I'm sure that is more than a coincidence. Now, I have too many friends who, around the 50 mark, have died of cancers. Far too many. Perhaps it was a coincidence once, but not anymore. There's just too many.
There's a remarkable parallel between the Kiwi soldiers and the North Vietnamese army whom they were sent to fight, in that they all went to South Vietnam, served, and then went home to uncontaminated places.
And then, 30 years later, they suffer the same range of illnesses. Liver cancer, soft tissue sarcomas, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, cancers of the larynx, trachea, bronchus and lung, prostate cancer, diabetes, stroke, neuropathy, multiple myeloma, chloracne, porphyria and heart disease, to name but a few. The destitute village of Cam Nia is in the highlands near the 17th parallel. A farming area, it was the site of the heaviest ranch hand spray concentrations of the war. It's had a hard history since then. It's known, colloquially, as the village of the damned. These two boys are badly affected with mutation. Blind, deaf, mute, and contorted, they're unable to care for themselves in any way. They depend on their mother 24 hours a day. She must also care for her similarly afflicted 80-year-old mother. There is no relief. This family had buried their eldest son, also horribly affected, just 2 days before. They were in mourning. He was the third of her 4 children whom she's had to bury. Only one remains. Dioxin poisoning has ongoing intergenerational impact, physically, emotionally, spiritually, and culturally. The Binh Hoa Peace Village in Ho Chi Minh City deals with babies and children afflicted with the devastation of genetic mutation. They require permanent care. This unit can only cope with the immediate local surrounds. They deliver 150 babies per day. 2% are born with difficulties. That's 3 more every day in this small corner of Saigon alone. Vietnamese agencies believe the numbers affected to be around 3 million. Next door at Tu Du Hospital is a locked room which bears silent witness to Vietnam's defoliant legacy. It contains the preserved bodies of mutated babies and fetuses. They're there as a record of the ongoing genetic mutation brought on by parental exposure to spray toxins. The dioxin contaminant in Agent Orange leaves a legacy that provokes horror. The birth defects inflicted on the children of those exposed defy description. It contorts limbs, disfigures minds, it makes grotesques of innocence. It's like the blueprint for the human being has been scrambled by a lunatic. You know, nature didn't just suddenly decide to abominate the genes of the Vietnamese. This is made by man. What is this contaminant in Agent Orange that could possibly cause such catastrophic results from exposure to it? Agent Orange was made by mixing 2 chemicals together, 245T and 24D, approximately 50-50. It produced a contaminant called dioxin, specifically 2378-TCDD tetrachlorodibenzoparadioxin. It is a human carcinogen and is the most toxic dioxin so far synthesized by man. By toxic, I mean really toxic.
1/1000th of a gram will kill a guinea pig, and it debilitates the immune system. The Environmental Research Foundation discovered that lab mice exposed to minute doses of dioxin and then exposed to the flu virus died in droves. To replicate that into human terms, a 150-pound human would take an aspirin-sized tablet, pulverize that into 470,000 pieces, and then take one piece.
Put another way, a mere 80 grams of the pure dioxin would be enough to wipe out a city of 8 million people. Approximately 46 million litres of Agent Orange and around 25 million litres of the other agents combined were sprayed onto Vietnam. It may have deprived the enemy of cover, but it also deprived the locals of food and the means of producing it. And the burning of those defoliated areas further spread and worsened the contamination with dioxin. And the companies producing the chemicals had known for years before the war that there were contamination problems. New Zealand veterans and their children are still finding illness and mental health problems occurring, and believe that their problems originate with exposure to Agent Orange. 33 chemical companies produced and marketed what are called chlorophenols, but two companies dominated the 2,4-D and 2,4,5-T market, Monsanto and Dow. 2,4,5-T was also manufactured here in New Zealand at the New Plymouth plant of Ivan Watkins Dow. By 1959, over 1 million gallons had been distributed to New Zealand farmers. Internationally, production and use of 2,4,5-T was stopped due to serious health concerns. Sweden led in 78 and the US followed in 83. But the New Plymouth factory was the last in the world still making it up until 1987. And Monsanto and Dow were aware before the Vietnam War that the dioxin contaminant in Agent Orange was toxic.
There is no longer any question that the chemical companies knew as early as 1962 that their 2,4,5-T was contaminated, and the material they sold the government was contaminated with 2,3,7,8 tetrachlorodibenzoparadioxin, TCDD or dioxin, one of the most toxic substances known to man. And they never, ever told anyone in the government about the contaminant, its danger, and the level of contamination.
The earliest record we have found of the identification of 2,3,7,8 TCDD was in a German paper that was written in German by German scientists in 1957. In terms of Dow's knowledge, we identified and determined analytical methods for this in 1964. Although we were aware of the existence of some impurity that could cause acneogenic problems when we started producing in 1950.
All this they knew as our Kiwi soldiers, the Australians and the US troops and the local Vietnamese lived and breathed a toxic soup. It was in the water, it was in the soil, it was in the food, it was in the very air they breathed. And dioxin became ever present.
I drank the water, I ate the food. I had an intimate relationship with the dirt for 12 months. I was indirectly exposed, whether I was directly sprayed or not.
And during the spraying regime in Vietnam, the authorities were alerted to its dangers. In 1967, 5,000 American scientists, including 17 Nobel laureates, petitioned President Johnson to halt the spraying, calling it a dangerous precedent that might further the use of chemical weapons. There was no official response. In fact, spraying was increased. By 1968, the USA was using the entire domestic production of 2,4,5-T in Vietnam. In December of 1970, US scientist Dr. Matthew Meeselson from Harvard University traveled to Vietnam to look at the dangers of spraying.
It certainly did amount to an effect on the people of Vietnam. We were led to believe, by discussing with Chemical Corps officers who escorted us on these trips, that their criteria, their precautions for avoiding exposure of indigenous civilian populations were a failure.
This was after Dow Chemical had told the U.S. government in 1969 what it had known for 5 years.
I remember very clearly when I got a call from the White House saying, we don't think it's the 245T itself. We've got some new information. Dow tells us that there's something in it called dioxin, and that may be the culprit. By culprit, I mean responsible in the bionetics tests that were done at the time, which showed that it caused birth defects and stillbirths and abortions in rats and mice.
Denial that Agent Orange had caused health problems in New Zealand veterans and their children continued. But veterans in the US and Australia continued putting their concerns to governments and veterans affairs organisations.
Here in Australia, there was a denial that that we'd sprayed herbicides in Vietnam. There was a denial that we'd been exposed to American spraying of herbicides. There was a denial that those herbicides, even if we had been sprayed with them, had any effect. In America, they couldn't deny that the herbicides were sprayed, but they did deny initially that there were any health effects.
Veterans Affairs in the US initially dismissed the soldiers' health concerns, but were then ordered by US Congress to investigate the veterans' claims.
After there's no evidence on the medical record, no evidence at the exit physical, no evidence right afterwards, then 10 years later, which is contrary to medical literature at this moment, based on advice that I've been given, then the individual says, boom, here I have a problem. That is the problem. Not the question about initial exposure to dioxin and what it can do, and not the question about whether animals, laboratory animals, monkeys, rats, are fed or injected dioxin. We know it's a poison, a very toxic substance, which is what concerns us. But how, our problem is, it seems to me, this is the crux of the matter, how does the laboratory situation of injecting rats or monkeys, or feeding rats and monkeys, how does that equate with an experience in Vietnam?
All the evidence is never in. Obviously, we're looking not for tying down a precise cause and effect relationship, which is very difficult to do, but we're looking for the best indications that we have. Now, for years, we have used animal studies as the best indicators that we have of hazard to human beings. That's why we do animal studies. The animal studies have shown increased frequency of cancers, particularly sarcomas. Liver and lung cancers have been documented. Liver, kidneys, lungs, nervous system, blood-forming organs, and the reproductive system have shown to be at hazard in the animal studies. Abortions, early death, and abnormal development of offspring in laboratory tests on females exposed to dioxin. Why do we have to have, Mr. Administrator, the last bit of cause-effect scientific evidence in the notebook before we take care of these men and their families?
In New York in 1984, on the eve of going to court, the seven nominated chemical companies in the Agent Orange class action lawsuit settled out of court for the sum of $180 million, although the companies withheld any admission of liability.
Well, we think from our experience that 245T is one of the safest and most carefully studied agricultural products that we have. It's also very clear that there is a real need for this sort of a product, and we think it would be rather unfortunate if an emotional reaction to a problem were allowed to prevail over all of this information. Since there is a need for the product, probably some other product would take its place, and the likelihood is that that product would be less studied or known to be less, not known to be more safe than 245T.
Allied veterans watched U.S. developments closely, with governments being forced to address the problem. Our own government seemingly took little notice of events, even if the Australians seemed more interested.
In Australia, in the 80s, there was a Royal Commission held into the Agent Orange issue, and the Royal Commissioner, Justice Philip Evatt, basically denied any exposure to Agent Orange by Australian service personnel and denied that any herbicide sprayed in Vietnam had any health effects.
The Evatt report in Australia became discredited, in part because it may have been somewhat less than accurate, and much of the Evatt report was almost an entirely verbatim incorporation of a submission by Monsanto of Australia. In 1989, Admiral Elmer Zumwalt the former U.S. commander of naval forces in Vietnam, and who had ordered the spraying of defoliants, determined two models for exposure to vets. The first said, if they were within 20 kilometers and 30 days of an Agent Orange flight, you were exposed. The second and adopted version stated, if a soldier served in Vietnam and was suffering from illness that could be Agent Orange related, you were exposed, end of story. Admiral Zumwalt's own son was sprayed in Vietnam and he died in 1988. His grandson is also deeply affected. In 1997, still under increasing pressure from veterans, the Australian government conducted a health study on veterans and their children. The results confirmed their fears.
What they found was a surprisingly high number of all birth defects, but particularly certain birth defects, including cleft lip and cleft palate, spina bifida, adrenal gland cancer, acute myeloid leukemia. So what... at this stage, there is no way that the children of Vietnam veterans can be included under the Veterans Entitlements Act, because the Veterans Entitlements Act is for veterans. But the Australian government has got around that by setting up a cooperation between the Department of Veterans Affairs and the Department of Health so that children of Vietnam veterans can be treated for those conditions. So there's an acknowledgement of responsibility by the Department of Veterans Affairs to treat those children. So it's a kind of admission that something in the father's war service caused those children to suffer those health effects.
Australia's position slowly changed from that of denial to acknowledging the US model that proof of Vietnam service was proof of exposure. New Zealand, however, did not.
Finally, in 1998, the New Zealand government under Sir Paul Reeves conducted an inquiry into New Zealand veterans' concerns about Agent Orange and their exposure to it. To their horror, Reeves' conclusions were similar to the discredited 1985 Australian Evatt report.
Of course it's frustrating that it's not more clear-cut, but that's the way it is. The scientific evidence and research is not able to be understood in a clear-cut fashion.
That produced a massive revulsion and anger and antipathy amongst the Vietnam veterans, because that became, of course, the official government policy on the subject.
New Zealand veterans complained that our government was now out of step with both Australia and the US. Parliament's response was to set up a government department inside the Department of Defence in 1999 called Veterans Affairs. In 2000, Prime Minister Helen Clark met with veterans, making it clear that she wanted this issue dealt with and to have closure. As a result of that meeting, Veterans Affairs commissioned a report from the Wellington School of Nursing in association with the Otago University. This became the McLeod Report, published in 2001. Veterans had high hopes that their experiences would at last be vindicated, but instead were outraged at its conclusions. The McLeod Report starts with one key sentence which says, "The information available to the authors was that Anzac forces generally served in Phuc Toi province, where there was no aerial spraying."
Clearly, if McLeod started her research on the basis that we weren't sprayed by Agent Orange, then it didn't matter whether it was another 5 pages or another 100 pages, she wasn't going to say that those soldiers who became fathers were going to pass any effects of chemical spraying onto their children. Ipso facto, my report says that there is no issue.
Veterans' distress at the McLeod Report then led the New Zealand government to set up a health select committee to investigate how McLeod and Veterans Affairs New Zealand could have come to the conclusions they had. Asked by New Zealand veterans, Lachlan Irvine, a PhD student, veteran and exposure victim himself, agreed to present his rebuttal of the McLeod Report.
McLeod took Reeves and Evatt as sources of information. So what you have here is government reports leading to other government reports leading to other government reports, and none of these researchers looking outside of this narrow source of information.
Retired Lieutenant Colonel John Masters then realised that he had evidence in his own home that could turn the McLeod Report on its head.
Well, in particular, map which was created by the Americans with an Australian overprint of the actual circumstances in 1971 when I was serving in Vietnam. It was marked very highly secret, etc., 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 because it showed two things. It showed all the defoliated areas in Phuc Thuy province in a standout yellow colour, and it showed all the fire bases and locations of Allied troops, and it showed unequivocally that those two pieces of information coincided on the map.
Retired Colonel Ray Seymour was asked by the Department of Defence to search Army files for evidence of spraying to report to the Health Select Committee.
I had no idea really what I was looking for, but fortunately I came across this comprehensive report compiled by the Australian Army and issued in 1982. And I did recall seeing in this rather lengthy tome about 18 pages of fairly detailed data which indicated grid references, dates, quantities of herbicide spray that was used and the like.
Also found by Ray Seymour was an unclassified letter from the New Zealand Embassy in Washington to Defence Headquarters in Wellington. Dated 1980, it listed grid references, dates and spray quantities used in Phuc Thuy province, the same detail that was in the Australian report.
That research indicated to me that no one else had ever gone through those files doing similar research at any time prior to me. How can I say that? Well, there was no evidence on the file in the form of a file note that in 1980, 1985, or any time, some person had access to those files.
Colonel Seymour presented his findings to the Health Select Committee.
Well, I produced, I think, about 14 or 16 colour-coded maps, not leaving, to my mind, any doubt in their minds that, first of all, herbicide spray had been sprayed in Phuc Thuy province, and that on a number of occasions, New Zealand troops had been exposed to that spraying.
Why has Veterans Affairs, the agency tasked with looking after veterans and their families, been so at odds with what their own soldiers witnessed and with what the Australians and the Americans had already accepted? Jesse Gunn, Director of Veterans Affairs, appeared before the Health Select Committee.
Do you now question the basis of that report?
I stand by the report in terms of I have yet to see other international research to tell me that there are additional disabilities or medical conditions that can be attributable to the parent's exposure during service.
But do you think the report was accurate in that regard?
If it is taken within context in terms of the exposure of New Zealand veterans versus American veterans, yes, I would probably have some concerns, but I would still accept the report.
What would be your concerns?
That perhaps Dr. McLeod didn't consider the depth of the exposure of the veterans, basically.
We made no claims or didn't make any attempts to assess levels of exposure of New Zealand veterans. We only had information that was provided to us on that, so we're not in a position to make any comment about that.
However, the first lines of the McLeod report state, "The purpose of this report has been to conduct a comprehensive and critical review of all available international research on the health of Vietnam and nuclear test veterans' children."
Any future government report can't do what McLeod did and simply accept the information that it had been fed from a previous government report because there is now more information out there that can't be denied.
So what position are our veterans and their families in today? It's a tacit agreement that soldiers cannot bring lawsuits against the Crown for injuries suffered during service. Yet their actions allow those still at home to continue and to prosper. And as a result, the government has a responsibility to diagnose and treat any injuries sustained as a result of that service. It's a form of social insurance. What worries our veterans is who will look after their children when they pass. Children whose disabilities and illnesses are a legacy of their father's service. Catherine Mary Brown was conceived 3 months after her father's return from Vietnam. He has 5 normal children from his first marriage prior to Vietnam. Now 36, Catherine is just one of the New Zealanders badly affected by her father's service. She is highly intelligent, gaining her BSc at 18, but she has suffered from a range of debilitating conditions throughout her life.
When I was 23, 24, I noticed a lump around about my waistband, and I didn't know what it was. And I noticed I couldn't wear skirts, but I thought it was something you could operate on. I did have a referral to have a hernia removed, of course. The surgeon thought it was a hernia too. Then another one cropped up, and another, in a symmetrical pattern on my nerves. And I went to see the dermatologist in the end because my doctor referred me, and he did a biopsy and found a fatty lump. And it was Durkheim's disease, and it's been spreading and growing ever since.
Catherine suffers many severe difficulties stoically. She has Asperger's syndrome. Noise and people terrify her.
I also have a regurgitation thing, and I took this particular medication called Motilium, and I started producing milk, and I was frightened. I didn't know what it was, and I had an MRI scan, and they found out I had this little tumour, a benign one on my pituitary gland. And I take a drug to control it, and every so often I go off the drug, but the tumour seems to grow back, so I have to go back on the drug again. Just lots of funny little things that I have that other people don't seem to have. It all seems to add up. And I know I have some half-siblings, and they don't seem to have all these things.
Catherine also has two-dimensional sight. Driving is impossible and crossing the street is dangerous. Her medical and pharmaceutical bills are crippling.
I thought that one day I might get married and have children of my own, but I couldn't possibly cope with that. The children would be too noisy for me. I couldn't cope with the responsibility. I'd be no sort of parent for them. So I just see this big black hole of poverty and loneliness and struggling from day to try and look after myself. That's it, really.
The depression, fear and suffering due to exposure and to what may occur to veterans and their children in the future has further exacerbated difficulties in the home. In an Australian study in 2005, it was discovered that the children of Vietnam veterans are 3 times as likely to commit suicide.
I've just taken this from a letter which was written to me in pencils a year or two ago. I love my dad, but by his mood changes to moments of mad, irrational violence, he has ruined my life. Mum has stuck by him, and that has kept us together. We get by, but I envy my friends who will never understand.
All our soldiers want and need is to have their children and further offspring ring-fenced from future health concerns.
Now, from the time that we came back, the governments of today and tomorrow and way into the future have a moral and legal responsibility in my book to make sure that any legacies, anything that we picked up from serving our country as we were asked, that we are looked after. That, and not just us, but future generations, because we've now found that there is warfare is getting nastier and nastier, and there is lasting legacies being given to people.
And after decades of little or lethargic response to their plight, our veterans remain sceptical about further government inquiries delivering the results they need.
Yes, they will want to have the final say, the final word. I'm not quite sure why. I wish I knew. They don't want us to talk. And I don't think they want us to talk publicly. I don't care now.
Well, I won't back down. No, I won't back down. You can stand me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down. Gonna stand my ground, won't be turned around. And I'll keep this world from dragging me down. Gonna stand my ground, and I won't back down.